Hi, I'm Chris Russell. When I was a judge on the New Inventors, we loved inventions that changed the game, particularly ones that transform food production. Now, Cedar Anderson and his father, Stuart, have done just that, simplifying honey harvesting by revolutionising the humble beehive. From living off the smell of an oily rag, they've now become multimillionaires. But how will they cope, moving from a simple life, tinkering in a shed, to running a complex international company? This is their story.
My grandfather kept bees, my father had bees, we had bees as a kid.
We used to pull apart the beehives using my mum's old hat and veils and rubber gloves and gaffer tape and so on around their socks.
There's me and my brother Chris getting the honey out, and they'd get so ferocious that I'd just have to stand back, you know. I thought there must be a way just to tap honey straight out of the hive without opening the hive. That is more gentle on the bees.
Okay.
That's the first drop, so it's pouring.
It's pouring in.
Okay, you can see the honey absolutely pouring out there. That is amazing.
The first successful attempt at getting honey out of a box without opening the hive.
Are you surprised that you've had this incredible response?
The media interest was massive. It was all over the world.
Who is here to tell us about a new beehive that makes harvesting honey a cinch.
It was then we realised that this was actually really big and we had to move really fast.
Dieses Bild hier haben wir im Internet gefunden und wir haben
uns. We had invented the beekeeper's dream. The idea of having a 9-to-5 office job was just frightening. To me, freedom is, you know, being able to do what I'm inspired to do. It's being able to work on inventions whenever I have an idea. I sit on the toilet, I look at the toilet roll and I go, how's that dispenser working? Oh, okay, why didn't they do it differently? You know, and that's what I did when I looked at a beehive. It's like, how does that all work? How do the bees work? How can we do it differently? How can we do it better?
When Cedar gets an idea, he's utterly tenacious. He really believes that if the human mind has worked something out, he can too.
I don't think anyone really ever told him what he had to do or that he had to pursue a certain career. And his upbringing allowed him to, you know, nurture his own natural curiosity and follow his own instincts.
A whole new wave of Nimbin pilgrims are still keen to discover an alternative to the consumptive society, a way of surviving with little.
I met my wife-to-be, Rada, at a healing festival, which is, you know, where everyone goes away with tropical ulcers and all sorts of sicknesses for those sort of healing festivals. And she was part of the group up here in northern New South Wales that wanted to form a community.
After the last festival, many stayed. Form communes, raised their children.
All the founders of our community decided to do something different, and I'm one of the children from there. It was a fantastic way to grow up. I just loved it. It's like its own little village, really, where everybody knows everybody, and it was freedom for us. 360 acres of forest and houses and places to play and swimming in the creek.
Cedar was such a dreamer when he was little. You know, it would take him half an hour to walk 10 minutes because he was always lost a bit in his own little world, and he's always kind of just walked to his own groove.
We didn't have TV, and so we'd invent all sorts of things to do for fun. We built this electric shock machine, I can remember. It was a hit amongst all of us kids. We'd join hands and sit around in a circle and hold onto these terminals and be getting this.
Oh, the wheels still roll.
My dad, he was the mechanic and the fix-it guy.
Yeah, much more fun than going to school.
We'd rig up the whole power system, so turbine in the creek, solar panels, batteries.
Much of the food for the 40 men and women in this community comes from the communal gardens.
It's not any particular person's garden. You know everybody and there's no stranger danger and you can just stroll around free, and that's been...
That's nice.
...one of the best things growing up here.
Neither of my parents did criticism, so there was this sense of encouragement all the time that really gave me a sense of I can do anything. And this sense of not afraid to have a go.
Have they been croaking loudly, have they?
Everywhere we would go together, he would want to help people. Like, you know, we'd turn up at someone's house and their dishwasher would be broken, and he'd just always have the time of day to fix it.
Somehow I grew up not in that rat race of having to have a 9-to-5 job. And that's allowed me basically to put time into this flow hive invention.
It was very quiet when it was. Yeah, 10 years ago, Seda had this idea, come on, we must be able to get honey from a beehive without opening it and extracting and stressing the bees and everything.
So that's the old style of frame.
And at the time I thought, whoa, you know, that is a big ask.
Now this is the tricky bit, trying to put this back on without squashing any bees.
For years I tried to get honey out of honeycomb cells that were fully formed. So yeah. Casting piston plungers that went down cells. You know, we want it to fit in standard boxes, we want it to be modular.
To my surprise, really I was surprised that Seda went away and started making them.
Let's see its breaking point. All right, there it was.
That was a bit crappy. So there was stage after stage after stage of inventing this thing.
Oh, one morning I remember clearly waking up and going, ah! It doesn't have to be honeycomb cells all the time. It can move apart and be not honeycomb cells when it's time to drain the honey.
Yeah. Seda sat there by hand cutting some of those prototypes and, you know, painfully cutting them out, you know, because that was, you know, the cheapest way to do it.
After a few strong coffees one morning, Stu goes, oh, how about instead of in the horizontal direction, we move it like that? And straight away I dropped everything. I was like, oh.
Their minds spark off each other and there's this really beautiful connection when they're working, looking at what things work, didn't work, and they're off and they're just like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And you go, guys, I need to, I'll just leave you to it.
Seda lives really humbly. He lives on this big bush block right next to the ocean near Byron Bay, and it's probably a good 15, 20 minutes drive over rough corrugated roads and just living really in a shed, essentially, which has half of the shed's devoted to beekeeping and his little inventing space there, and then the other half is the house that he shares with his partner. You know, I think over the years he's tried to add some mod cons to it, a dishwasher and...
We actually call ourselves the Wombles of Wimbledon. Do you remember that? Making good use of the things that you find, things that the everyday folk leave behind. That was us.
I was borrowing money off family and friends. I was doing just the odd job, just enough to pay the bills, but my main focus would just be on the invention.
The two outer cones.
I think there were times where I was wondering whether it would be successful, you know, and sort of how long we could keep going if it wasn't.
My dad helped fund the prototypes and the patents, which, you know, made it possible for Seda and I to move ahead without running around the countryside looking for money.
There's another patent beyond this one, which isn't published.
The flow hive is a frame, a honeycomb matrix as such, built out of plastic. When the cell is filled with honey and capped off by the bees, a lever is turned and the cell splits, and the honey then drains down through the channel that makes out a tube into a jar at the bottom.
We finally had a prototype in the hive that we really hoped would work.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
And it was time to test this invention. The bees had actually built onto our prototype, which was exciting.
We've got two levers here.
And it was time to turn a spanner on the outside of the hive and see if it actually worked.
So I'm going to do that now from here. I'm rolling it.
Wow, look, it's just starting to flow down the tube.
Oh, yes. There it goes.
There it goes.
That's the first drops and it's pouring.
It's pouring in.
Hooray.
Excellent.
It's really pouring. Look at the height of it in there.
Yay.
Look, we've done it.
That's incredible. It's just streaming out into the trough at the bottom. I'll look at it just filling into the jar. It's just pouring in.
Could totally revolutionise the way that apiary is done today.
We just laughed, didn't we? It's just unbelievable. People say inventors forget everything when they see their invention work for the first time. They forget the whole world around them. I just remember lying back on the grass and going, you know, we've done it. So we had the invention. Now it's how do we get it to market?
Even though we'd grown up as hippie children playing in the forest and that we come from that background, we're not against technology. Zeta and Stu both wanted to use crowdfunding to fund the project rather than get investors. And so crowdfunding basically is where you approach the world and put forward a video saying, this is my idea, this is what I want to make. Will you support it, donate or purchase?
Before the crowdfunding campaign began, I actually found out I was pregnant. I think it just sort of gave him a bit of a kick up the butt, really, as well. Okay, well, we've got to do this crowdfunding thing now. You know, we've got to do it before this baby comes.
Zeta was thinking sort of on a worldwide level from the word go.
All right, ready to roll?
And he had our sister Mirabai on deck. She is a professional filmer.
All right.
And so she did a bunch of the videos.
Yeah, that looks good.
That looks really cool.
Come back a bit.
Yeah.
Look at it, it's Photoshop. Yeah.
We worked and we worked and we reshot and we refilmed and we tweaked because we're all learning, you know.
For those that don't know, harvesting your honey used to be a real labour of love. You had to crack the hive open, pull out the frames, trying not to squash bees, brush them off the comb, transport the frames to a processing shed, cut the wax capping off, filter the honey and clean up all the mess. Then the frames have to go back to the hives again.
We didn't know. It's like, oh, maybe it is just some crazy idea from hippies on the North Coast.
It's interesting. The bees are a little bit hungry.
And we had no idea that it would go to the level it did.
We have been looking forward to this moment of telling the world about it.
So the crowdfunding campaign kicked off on Monday and we're hoping to raise $70,000 to set up a bigger tool in the factory.
Zeta and Stu were actually in Canberra to do the media launch. So I called in some friends who were helping out to have our little launch here at our kitchen table at headquarters.
Do you want me to launch it? Yeah, launch
it. Okay, good. We're launching. Here we go.
Almost ready to go live. Now what do we do?
Oh, no.
So this hasn't been filled out yet? So this stuff has to be filled out?
We
already filled out the basic.
Oh, my God.
All our laptops were here on the table and everyone's just sort of going hell for leather trying to do their little last-minute things and it was just a huge buzz.
Woohoo!
Is it live?
It's live!
Let's check it.
We're live.
Emails are going.
The target was 70 grand and we reached it in 2 minutes. That's what we needed to manufacture, and we're already there.
We overwhelmed the crowdfunding website. Broke, you know, one of the biggest crowdfunding platforms in the world. When we had people screaming out, take our money, people were buying. They didn't even know what they were buying. It was a frenzy. It was like a rock concert. You know, our Facebook page was just inundated. All the product we knew we could make at our existing factory in Brisbane, we'd sold out in 15 minutes. And everyone looked around the room to each other and I said, well, what are we going to do now? And so I called Cedar up on the phone. He was in the middle of an ABC interview.
I'm in shock. I don't quite
know. Here's the crew ringing. It's pretty exciting.
And it's a wonderful moment. Oh, that's the team now. And they're like, you can't, you're in the middle of an interview. But it was just, it was panic stations, you know.
Then there's people jumping around in the background going, it's been 5 minutes and you've reached your target.
$200,000, guys.
I was just like, oh, this is too exciting. I can't do this interview anymore.
So in 15 minutes, we'd raised $250,000.
We have to make sure we can deliver, so we have to add some more time to it.
You know, the fastest campaign to ever hit $1 million, the fastest to get to $2 million.
The launch of a new free-flow beehive in recent weeks has had investors swarming. The Flow Hive was created by two Northern Rivers backyard beekeepers who were determined to find a simpler way to harvest their honey. They ended up harvesting money as an online crowdfunding initiative took off, with more than $2 million pledged. Here's Adrian Francis.
Father and son Stuart and Cedar Anderson are honey hobbyists from the Northern Rivers of New South Wales. This slick and feel-good campaign of theirs is one of the latest crowdfunding success stories. Instead of applying for a bank loan or grant, crowdfunding allows people seeking money to post a description of their project and a fundraising target online. Sponsors can donate small amounts to help the project take flight, and the crowdfunding website makes money through a levy on the total funds raised. In most cases, if the project fails to reach its target, the pledge amounts are cancelled and returned.
And we really need your help to get the word out there, to build a buzz and build a community of beekeepers around the globe.
Keeping bees in an entirely new way.
If you'd like to support us, like our Facebook page, join our mailing list and stay in the loop.
Look, honey.
The entrepreneurs chose this backyard in suburban Canberra to launch the public fundraising campaign to manufacture their breakthrough trademarked hive. No one seemed more surprised by the overwhelming interest they're receiving than the dazed inventors themselves, the father a former community worker and the son a paragliding pilot, musician and surfer.
It's been so overwhelming, the response we've gotten. I mean, to have 1.8 million people view our Facebook video, and it's only been up for a week. We've been snowballed by interest, and every other second there's another email in the inbox. It's I haven't slept for days.
Their invention is called a Flow Hive. It features a plastic inbuilt honey extractor.
What we've done is created artificial honeycomb or matrix that the bees then build their wax honeycomb on. And with the manipulating of the lever on the outside of the hive, the honeycombs, which are all hexagonal cells like this, split like that. So instead of being a cell, it's now become a vertical channel. The honey will flow down those channels with the capping that the bees have put on the outside intact. Inside, the honey will flow down into a channel on the outside and out of the hive.
It sounds so simple, but the breakthrough itself was far from it.
You know, for us, the honey wasn't our breadwinner, so we don't come from the background of that having to be our commercial business. For us, it was more about, I can't help but think there has to be a better way. Pulling the hive apart, disrupting the bees, running across the paddock because the hive's angry and you've forgotten your bee gloves.
I'm a very, very lucky dad, you know, to work that closely with my son. I have three other children and I'm close with them as well. And I think every parent probably longs to feel that sort of sense of, I wonder if we could do more together, even just go to the movies. But I've been with Cedar day in, day out, working on this invention, our minds sparking off each other.
I actually didn't once think of giving up.
So Cedar and Stuart Anderson tinkered away together for a decade.
First time we got a large amount of honey out of the hive, that was down in the paddock where we're just there with the bees and a blue sky. And we've got this contraption inside the hive that we've rigged up, and we've 3D printed different parts, and we've got a spanner on the outside to turn this mechanism. And we hoped it would work. Our test showed that it should work. And we turned the handle and we waited. And then the first pour of fresh honey came out filling the jar. Oh, that was a moment. That was really something to just go, we've done it.
It's such a revolutionary way to get something out of the hive without having to open the hive up. So it's going to have a really good environmental feel about it, a feel-good factor, but it's also, from a beekeeper's point of view, it's such an unmessy way to extract honey, and you don't need extracting equipment. All you need is a tube and a jar, and you can get the honey out of the hive. You don't need to spend $400, $500 minimum to get extracting equipment and have honey spread throughout your house while you're trying to extract it.
The feedback on social media ahead of the fundraising launch showed there was enormous interest among American backyard beekeepers. So at the 11th hour, Cedar and Stuart Anderson switched from a crowdfunding platform that only accepted Australian currency to a US site. That decision paid big dividends for the duo.
The target was 70 grand and we reached it in 2 minutes. That's what we needed to manufacture and we're already there.
2 minutes.
And
yeah. I'm in shock. I don't quite
here's
know.
Here's the crew ringing. It's pretty exciting.
They need some more pledges up, don't they?
They do.
Within the first 8 hours, more than $1.5 million poured in via this crowdfunding site, and the kitty continues to grow.
We have to make sure we can deliver, so we have to add some more time to it.
$200,000, guys.
Well, it really showcases the power of the community. Typically, crowdfunding has been used for software and other IT-related products, and now that it's making a move into agriculture is exceptional. We're probably going to see a lot more agricultural-related crowdfunding projects that are going to make big changes in industries like beekeeping and even other kind of agricultural products.
Raising money for a crowdfunding project relies heavily on trust, and there are few safeguards to stop donors being ripped off.
It's about launching this campaign on Indiegogo. It's about getting support. It's about unleashing this invention to the world of beekeepers in the hope that it will fascinate a lot more beekeepers, get beekeepers in touch with their bees more, enable people to harvest their honey in a way that doesn't disturb the hive so much.
But other beekeepers strongly disagree, saying the invention is unnecessary, misleading and disruptive for bees. Critics have even dismissed it online as a drain hive. Stuart and Cedar Anderson acknowledge there is some resistance to their approach, and initially their invention was dismissed by many as a fake. But they also maintain their invention isn't a silver bullet for harvesting honey, meaning bees and hives still need very skilled and ongoing nursing.
Because a beekeeper still has to care for the health of their hive, they still have to open it and be involved. In some ways you can be more in contact with your bees because of we've invented this clear window at the end of the hive rather than at the side, which is often there. Keeping out, yeah, there's slack beekeeping already. There's people that just don't have the time to attend to their bees. That was, I've got plenty of examples of that. And so we think what we've invented will help people have the time to just observe and be with their bees and look after their health and not be just so consumed with the whole honey-robbing process, because that is so time-consuming.
Cedar and Stuart Anderson hope to begin flow hive manufacturing in Brisbane soon, and the mini moguls also plan to manufacture in America later this year.
We'll still keep our manufacturing in Australia. We really like the idea of making it Australian-made, and we'll continue to do that. But it doesn't make sense to be shipping a lot of product from Australia to America. It just makes it too expensive.
It's wonderful to think of not having to worry about money. I've been skidding along the bottom for a few years because I've been dedicating most of my time to this. And, being rich isn't so important, but not having to worry about money is lovely. Yeah.
We were just shocked, you know, we didn't even have time to pop the champagne.
They're setting a crowdfunding record thanks to a revolutionary beehive innovation.
Cedar was sort of talking about things going viral, and I'm thinking, you know, darling, it's a beehive, you know. It's not a cute little kitten. It's, you know, it's probably not going to go viral.
This week, a new product hit the internet, and it's been creating a lot of buzz.
It's the most significant beekeeping innovation in decades.
But we're getting 50 new media inquiries every day.
Mich hat gestört, dass beim Ernten oft Bienen zerquetscht werden.
I would wake up at 5 in the morning and be talking to ABC Radio. And then a little bit later I'd be talking to Washington Post. And a little bit later I'd be talking to the New York Times.
I think it was 3 months of sleepless nights and thinking of all the things that had to happen and, you know, pulling in more and more people. I think in the first day we had 8 or 9 people working on the emails, just trying to answer them. And as they would reply, the emails would come in, pouring in.
This is a one-liner.
This is, okay, go do the one-liner. This is about freezing temperatures.
It was the craziest, busiest time that's ever happened to me, being pulled and stretched in every direction and, you know, also, you know, experienced anxiety for the first time in my life, and at the same time we're trying to have a baby.
We're halfway through the campaign and I just kicked everyone out. I'm like, I need space, I need to nest. I thought I'd have a month, but our little darling boy came 2 weeks early.
Hey Miris. You know how we shot the flow hive on the table rotating?
Crowdfunding, new baby, media attention, suddenly being in a very, very different world than what we were used to. You know, our lives completely changed.
We're finished. It's over.
It's over. We're home. It's done.
0 time left.
By the end of the crowdfunding campaign, we had orders from 140 different countries. We had $12.2 million in orders. And what a dream for an inventor.
Do you think we got enough orders?
That's the largest fully funded campaign ever launched outside of the US.
It's just been amazing the way all of you have jumped on board and just put in, you know, 120%.
The Flow Hive is great for attracting interest into beekeeping and the importance of bees, but if these hives become neglected, because people then lose interest quite quickly, those hives could develop disease and that disease could spread to other colonies in the environment, and that could be very dangerous for beekeeping in this country.
We absolutely insist that you need to join your local bee group. You need to engage with the elders, you know, with the beekeepers that are already there, that have a wealth of knowledge, and it's really important to learn what you need to do to look after your hive.
After looking over the patent and doing some thinking, I have to say, I'm not a fan.
We've got a whole bunch of people really excited about it. We've got another whole bunch of people that are really trying to slam us.
This Flow Hive product feeds into that consumer mindset of take, take, take.
Yeah, battery farming for bees is quite funny, or bee slaves, I think we've heard as well.
And, of course, then feelings of anxiety come up of what are we going to do? How are we going to deal with this? And in the end, we decided it was best to do nothing.
You got them off on that side? Are they all off? Because they're all off on this side.
There are a small group of beekeepers in this country who use a method they call natural beekeeping, and they're not particular fans of the flow hive system.
So here we're taking the whole comb and the honey. That's a natural way of harvesting. There we go.
Great invention, a clever idea, but for the bees to build their own comb is very important. They can build the cells the size that they need.
So it's a little bit harder than harvesting out of a flow hive or a conventional Langstroth hive. It's you have to be more careful, it's slower.
So things like the plastic in the hive, we are a bit worried about it. Who wants to live in a plastic environment, you know?
On one hand, we are putting something artificial into a beehive, but in doing so, we're getting a very useful, gentle way to harvest honey from a beehive.
So after the crowdfunding finished, you know, we had a whole new set of problems that we had to deliver this product. We had, I think, 24,500 orders sitting there waiting for somebody to deal with them. So all the money that we've raised is, we don't really know what the profit margin is.
It's been a huge logistical exercise that's still going on, not only to manufacture the various things in Brisbane and so on, but for them to be assembled and boxed and packaged and sent to people all around the world.
First pallet load, on its way.
Cedar has always been the type of guy who actually doesn't really know what day it is. You know, he just lives moment to moment.
Hey, morning.
Now he's running this big business.
All right, we got the new pickies up.
And he has to be at meetings on time, which he sometimes still doesn't quite get to.
Yeah, the stats are looking good.
Is this morning? This is the
mainland. Stress is probably a new word in Cedar's vocabulary. It's not something that he's experienced before.
And we could actually break down the stats and have a look at the orders that have come in just for...
All of a sudden they're telling me I have to have an office. I don't want an office, you know? That's my worst nightmare. But okay, we need an office, so we've got an office now. And now they want me to go to the office. And so it's this steep learning curve of okay, what do we need to run a company?
We've had this massive event, which is a huge amount of work to process in a very short time. And then parallel to that, we're trying to build, you know, we're trying to say, hey, what is our ongoing business model?
Yeah, it's really difficult, I think, for Cedar to go from, you know, trying to conserve resources and money so much for, you know, just for the sake of not affecting our environment, our planet anymore, to having to, you know, run this multi-million dollar business and spend.
I don't like to be a consumer, right? So then when part of the team is saying, look, we need new computers, we need this, we need that.
We need new gear. We need to get proper equipment because if you don't, you know, like just every second counts and, you know, very inefficient if you're working on an old and slow computer.
I'm like, well, I've never brought a new computer in my life. You can't have a new computer. What are you talking about?
So there's really been no change for him, although I do think he went out and bought a new pair of boots the other day, which is a first for Cedar.
We only charged a very small amount of shipping.
Looking like you're going to get on time.
We will be just on time.
He's just throwing himself into being, yeah, the head of this business. And he just keeps on going and going and going until you sort of, okay, it's time to have a break. It's time to actually, we might have to be like everyone else and have a weekend. Yeah.
So how about we put the words on there and we provide them a little kit with a piece of sandpaper if they want to attack
you. Here in the shed for years just working on my own, and now I've got, you know, 20 amazing people to work with, but that's a real stretch.
How did we ever get anywhere?
I'm not used to calling the shots. I'm not used to managing people. I'm not used to telling people what to do. And, you know, it's something that doesn't come naturally and that I'm being forced to learn in a hurry.
I don't think Cedar and Stuart are really going to change their lifestyle.
Now we're about to times those issues by 25,000.
Yeah, that's right.
The money has never really been the thing for them. They've got bigger ambitions than money.
So I'm just going to make that slightly shorter then.
Cedar and Stuart are still driving their old Hilux utes and they're running them still on vegetable oil, which is what they've done for quite a long time now, so I don't think you change those guys, no matter what you do.
It's been an amazing thing to work with my dad. To me, the most important thing is that relationship stays strong.
To me, I'd throw it all away if it was threatening our relationship.
Yeah, it's a big thing to say, but I feel the same.
You know, Stu to me has been the best dad ever, still is.
I've had people go, oh, you're working with your family, like, ooh, watch out. And I'm like, well, I think my family's different. We love each other enough and we have the ability to communicate well enough that if there was ever an issue, it would get talked about.
So many years of family having to keep this a secret. A toast to finally being able to tell the world. It is a big family project where we've involved everybody from uncles to brothers, my grandfather, my sisters, cousins.
It just hits me every now and again. I'm just like, oh my gosh, Sita, look what you just did. Can you believe that?
Yeah. Bye, Charlie.
I don't know.
It's a total roller coaster. It's euphoric.
See ya.
Even now, I pinch myself and it still doesn't feel real.
Here we go, darling boy. Here we go. Wanna go on an adventure?
Yeah, it's funny. I don't feel like a millionaire at all. I feel still the same as I always was.
I did ask Sita the other day, like, darling, is there anywhere in the world you'd like to travel? You know, we could go travelling somewhere. And he's like, I'd really like to go to Fraser Island. I was like, that's doable, seeing it's only a couple of hours up the road. We'll go there in our ute.
Brush them away so you don't squash them.
Just on the edges, the middle bit's alright?
Yeah, the middle's fine. Just around that rim. Lovely. Swarm in a box.